ETF Prime is hosted by investment advisors at the ETF Store and sponsored by Legg Mason. Legg Mason's sponsorship is not an endorsement nor a recommendation for any product or service. Legg Mason Investor Services LLC is not affiliated with the ETF Store, ETF.com, or any of its affiliates. The ETF Store is not affiliated with ETF.com or any of its affiliates. ETF.com's participation in this program should not be construed as an endorsement or an indication by ETF.com of the value of any ETF Store product or service. This program is for informational purposes only and does not constitute investment advice. All investing involves risk, including the potential loss of principal. Past performance is no guarantee of future results. The ETF Store owns and is responsible for all program content. Visit ETFstore.com for more information.
Legg Mason is a leading global investment company committed to helping clients reach their financial goals through long-term actively managed strategies. Legg Mason offers a broad range of equity, fixed income, alternative, and cash strategies worldwide. It is comprised of a diverse family of specialized investment managers, each with their own independent approach to research and analysis, and has over a century of experience in identifying opportunities and delivering astute investment solutions to clients. To learn more, please visit leggmason.com.
Now it's time for ETF Prime, where we discuss everything you need to know about exchange-traded funds and the world of investing. Whether you're an investing expert or just starting out, Nate and Connor will help you get up to date on what's happening on Wall Street and show you how exchange-traded funds can help lower your investment costs, reduce your tax bill, and allow you to take advantage of investment opportunities around the world. And now, the host of ETF Prime, Nate Geraci.
All right, nice show for you this week. As always, I want to thank the exclusive sponsor of ETF Prime, Legg Mason. If you look at the stock market run over the past 10 years or so, and certainly more recently, technology stocks have clearly been a big driver. Of course, the FANG stocks have received a ton of attention, even though not all of those are considered tech stocks anymore. But what's interesting is that when you have an area of market leadership like we've seen with tech, with that strong performance, you begin to see more ETFs launching in that area, and you start to see that sector getting sliced thinner and thinner. And that's exactly what's happening with tech ETFs. So there are now cybersecurity ETFs, cloud computing ETFs, virtual reality, mobile payments, 5G, the list goes on and on. In just a moment, we'll be joined by ETF.com's Laura Krieger to discuss this growing area of what you might call alternative tech ETFs. And along with that, later in the show, we'll do a deep dive into one of these ETFs that just launched last week, the Amplify Crowd Bureau peer-to-peer lending and crowdfunding ETF. We'll be joined by the founder and CEO of Amplify, Christian Magoon. But Connor, this alternative tech ETF space is intriguing because you have this combination of performance, at least right now, and then you have exciting themes, right? This stuff always seems to capture the imagination of investors. You're sort of peering into the future. These are the ETFs you talk about at the cocktail party.
You know, that's exactly right, because technology, it seems like it's always captured the investor's attention. You know, you look at how the future could be changed or improved by some industry or invention. You know, the term disruptive technologies is used often, and the possible higher returns that can come along with that, that gets investors excited without a doubt. And if you look at the recovery in the U.S. since, you know, 2009, tech stocks have absolutely outperformed almost everything else in the past, you know, going on 10 years here. And that kind of performance gets attention. And like you said, Nate, we've started to see the broad tech market cut up into a bunch of niche ETFs. So the questions, you know, investors have to ask themselves are, you know, what kind of exposure is right for me? Should it be a broad ownership of the entire tech sector, or is it owning a few niche ETFs for industries like, you know, robotics or cybersecurity or even 3D printing? We'll get into the positives and, frankly, perhaps negatives of these smaller niche ETFs with both Laura and Christian today, who are just going to be phenomenal resources on this topic.
All right. Also this week, we'll be joined by Michael Lovett, head of Vanguard's RIA group. We're going to discuss Vanguard's latest round of ETF fee cuts, 21 ETFs in all, including their two largest ETFs. And I noted this last week, but Bloomberg's James Seifert calculated that with the current dollars invested in these ETFs, these fee cuts would save investors nearly $90 million each and every year, which is just remarkable to me. you know, like this should be an interesting conversation because we're going to get a behind the scenes look at how Vanguard sort of thinks about and strategizes around fees and fee cuts. And we're also going to wade into this advisor fee discussion, which does seem to be gaining a lot more attention recently.
It has. And look, whether it's fund fees or advisor fees more recently, fees are driving a lot of the discussion for investors. And with the first negative fee ETF approved just yesterday, and I'm sure we'll discuss that on an upcoming show. It's a perfect time to chat with Vanguard because, look, they are viewed across the industry as the leading driver of lower fees. And it's going to be fun to dig in to these topics of both fund fees and advisor fees, more broadly speaking, in our industry with Michael here coming up.
All right. As always, if you have questions or comments, you can visit etfprime.com or you can find me on Twitter at Nate Geraci. Also, if you enjoy ETF Prime, we would greatly appreciate if you could leave us a quick review on iTunes. Let's talk tech ETFs with ETF.com's Laura Krieger.
Time now for our weekly chat with the experts at ETF.com, the world's leading independent authority on ETFs.
People have been saying there are too many mutual funds since the 80s. We're all talking smart beta. They haven't pulled in huge assets. The active managers are showing up in the ETF space.
Laura, right now, ETF.com shows over 70 technology ETFs with nearly $100 billion in assets. Of course, at the top of that list, you have two very popular broad-based tech ETFs, right? The Vanguard Information Technology ETF, ticker VGT, and the Technology Select Sector Spider ETF, XLK. Those two have over $20 billion each. But as I mentioned at the top, we are now seeing a growing number of more niche or alternative tech ETFs coming to market. And so just looking at some launches this year, and this isn't an exhaustive list, but we've seen the Goldman Sachs Motif Data-Driven World ETF, the Defiance Next-Gen Connectivity ETF, 5G, the ARK FinTech Innovation ETF, the Amplify Crowd Bureau Peer-to-Peer Lending and Crowdfunding ETF, which we'll actually be spotlighting later in the show. Do the ETF launches here surprise you at all? Or do you think it makes sense just given tech's performance and investors' interest in these areas? I just always think it's fascinating to see where ETF providers think the market is moving to.
Sure, sure. So I'm not really that surprised that issuers are drilling down into more and more granular segments of the tech market. I feel that they sort of have to these days because technology isn't so much a sector anymore, but it's an ecosystem. It's an economic ecosystem. The lines are blending between technology and pretty much every other sector out there, financials, healthcare, and consumer products, and so on. But what that means is that if every company is a tech company, then no company is a tech company. And people typically go to the tech sector for growth potential, for access to innovative ideas, for the next hot trend, that sort of thing. But those aspects are not being confined or concentrated into a single sector anymore. Instead, I think to get that same exposure to that kind of tech, that historical tech growth potential, you have to think in terms of theme, right? So the theme of artificial intelligence revolutionizing the workplace, or the theme of the Internet of Things transforming our global infrastructure, that sort of thing. That's where the growth and that's where the opportunity lies.
No, that's a really good point. Yeah, no, I was just going to say, because you're right, technology touches everything now. It touches every industry. So what is technology anymore? I thought you described that perfectly.
It's not so much. I think we're in this mindset that technology is a set of things or a set of products, and we have to move away from that. It's more of an expression of an idea. That's all I was going to say.
All right. So on the topic of new ETF launches in the quote-unquote tech space, you wrote a piece last week highlighting the Global X Cloud Computing ETF, ticker symbol CLOU. So this just launched a little over a month ago, and it already has 100 mil plus in assets. And what's interesting about that is there's a much larger cloud computing ETF out there, the First Trust Cloud Computing ETF, ticker SKY, S-K-Y-Y. But that's only taken in about 50 mil over the same time period. So this isn't a situation where the Global X ETF is, you know, some sort of brand new concept. What's going on with this one?
Right. And more than that, the Global X product is actually more expensive than SKY. which is not a story that we often see, right? The more expensive fund
right.
is taking assets from the existing competitor. So, you know, some of it I'm sure has something to do with brand recognition, right? Global X is, they have a slew of thematic funds, and doing thematic well is kind of what they hang their hat on. But specific to CLOU, CLOU, I think there are two big reasons that are sort of interrelated, and the first is performance. Of the three computing cloud computing ETFs out there, there's Sky, and then there's one from Tortoise, TCLD. CLOU, the Global X Fund, is just beating the pants off of them in just the month that it's been on the market. And the reason for that performance, and I think this is why the flows have been so huge, is that the Global X's portfolio, their ETF's portfolio, is way different than that of Sky or TCLD. We're talking like 95 to 96% difference in holdings. It's a vastly different portfolio with different names, and it's also a more pure play take on the space. Sky and TCLD, they place more of their emphasis on those big tech conglomerates that participate in the cloud computing space, but which don't really focus on it. Companies like Amazon or Microsoft, you know. So in that regard, Sky and TCLD are much more like the traditional broad tech plays that everybody's familiar with versus a narrow pure play on cloud computing, which is the Global X Fund.
There may be an obvious answer to this question, but when you look at thematic ETFs, and we talk about these alternative tech ETFs, in terms of finding success, does it ultimately come down to performance? Is that everything here?
No, at least in this space, right? So in the alternative technology ETF space, you have to be careful what you're comparing to, what benchmark you're comparing to, because technology ETFs kind of across the board, all of them outperform the broader S&P 500. But many of these narrow thematic ETFs in the alt tech space, they aren't outperforming, or they're only just barely outperforming the broad tech sector plays like XLK and VGT that you mentioned earlier. More than that, a lot of these funds are new. They don't have very long track records. So there's not a whole lot of data with which to work from in terms of performance comparisons. So there's a lot of noise in the signal. I think it's not so much that investors are looking for performance, but the promise, the potential of outperformance that they've historically associated with the tech sector.
We're visiting with ETF.com's Laura Krieger. Laura, all right, so I'm going to go potluck here. I want to throw out a laundry list of quote-unquote alternative technologies where we now have ETFs. I'll let you pick which one you'd like to discuss. So let's see. We have quantum computing, virtual reality, cybersecurity, mobile payments, server farms, artificial intelligence, which you mentioned earlier. Anything here you find particularly interesting?
I think one of the most interesting alt tech ETFs, one of the most interesting stories in technology today is happening around 5G, right? Cell phones are everywhere. Everybody has a smartphone. And increasingly, more people have smartphones than they have computers. And that sort of mobile technology, mobile networking technology, underpins everything we do. And we're in the middle of this vast transition worldwide from 4G to 5G networking technology and networking infrastructure that is going to not only change the way that smartphones work, but it's going to enable things like the Internet of Things and so on and so forth. So it's a really big story that I think a lot of investors are overlooking because nobody really kind of understands how it works. So, and that's fair. It's a complicated concept. But it is a very important one. So there are currently, there's one pure play 5G ETF out there. There's soon to be another one. The first one is from Defiance. There's a slew of really interesting tech ETFs. It's the Defiance Next Gen Connectivity ETF. The ticker's 5G, FIVG. And that one's doing pretty well. It's been around for about 2 months. It's already to about $80 million in assets. That's pretty good for a narrow thematic ETF from a boutique issuer. The other 5G ETF that's on the way is from First Trust, and they're going to be converting an existing smartphone ETF, the First Trust NASDAQ Smartphone Index Fund, ticker PHONE, F-O-N-E. They're going to be converting that from a smartphone ETF to a focus on 5G. And PHONE, I understand why they're doing it, because PHONE never really kind of took off in terms of assets or anything like that. So it'll be interesting to see if it can kind of hold its own against 5G.
Laura, you mentioned the words pure play several times, and you touched on this a bit earlier, but one of the questions that always comes up around these thematic ETFs, these more niche ETFs, is just how pure play they actually are, right? You look at some of the names of these ETFs, they look really exciting. You have these fun ticker symbols. But the question is, what are investors really getting in terms of exposure? How big of an issue is that?
You said it, right? It's everything, because if you're using these thematic ETFs, let me back up a sec. I think investors view thematic ETFs as the new stock picking, right? You said it earlier. It's the cocktail hour ETF that you talk about, the quantum computing ETF, the 5G, the 3D printing. They're the hot, you know, they're the new stocks, really. And so if you're focusing on thematic ETF investing as your new stock picking, I think these kinds of investors are more than pretty much everybody else. You need to be able to peek under the hood of that thematic ETF and make sure that that allocation is exactly along and aligned with the theme that you're hoping that you're investing in. A lot of these thematic ETFs out there, especially kind of the legacy funds that may have been rushed to market in order to kind of grab that first mover advantage in the space, they might have portfolios that are maybe a little less in line with what you think, a 3D printing or a 5G or a cloud computing ETF ought to be.
Well, and I think along with that, look, you have to know you're making a bet, right? This is a bet,
right,
on a very narrow segment of the market. And so if you're going to look at these thematic ETFs, obviously these should be small satellite holdings in a well-diversified portfolio. But you have to know, there's going to be a lot of potential risk and volatility here. There may be outsized returns. But these are, when you talk about disruptive technologies and some of these new spaces, again, you never know exactly what you're going to get. Laura, we're going to have to leave it there. Excellent insight, as always. Appreciate you joining us this week.
Thank you for having me on, as always.
That was ETF.com's Laura Krieger. Let's take a break, and when we come back, we'll be joined by Vanguard's Michael Lovett. We'll discuss Vanguard's latest round of ETF fee cuts, and we'll also get into ETF and advisor fees in general, just what the future might look like here. You're listening to ETF Prime. Welcome back to ETF Prime. Nate Geraci alongside Connor Kelly. And we're now very pleased to be joined by the head of Vanguard's RIA group, Michael Lovett. Michael is on the executive team for Vanguard's financial advisor services business. He's responsible for distributing all of Vanguard's products to RIAs across the country and helping them grow their businesses. And of course, Vanguard is currently the second largest ETF provider with nearly $1 trillion in ETF assets. Michael is on the line with us from Malvern, Pennsylvania. Michael, thank you for joining us this week.
Thanks, Nate. It's a pleasure to be with you this morning.
So, Michael, let's start with Vanguard's most recent ETF fee cuts. These were announced a few weeks ago, 21 ETFs in all, impacting some $660 billion in investor assets. These included Vanguard's two most popular ETFs. Now, I guess I don't think we can talk about these fee cuts without first discussing Vanguard's unique structure. So let's maybe start there. For people unfamiliar, can you explain Vanguard's structure? And I know what some refer to as the Vanguard flywheel.
Yeah, no problem at all. So I'll start with the structure. So Vanguard is actually a mutual company. So what that actually means is the underlying investors actually own Vanguard. So if you think about a company, the company is listed on the stock exchange, it's owned by its investors. They actually get dividends through when that company makes a profit. What Vanguard does is it hopefully makes a profit, which we have successfully done over many years, but instead of giving that back to the investors as dividends, we give it back to the investors in the terms of lowering their expense ratios on the relevant funds or ETFs.
Well, and you talk about giving those savings back to investors. I saw the stat from Bloomberg's James Seifert that these fee cuts on these 21 ETFs would save investors nearly $90 million each and every year at the current asset levels. With these recent fee cuts, can you give us any insight into the decision-making process here? Is it just black and white, you know, look at the numbers, go from there, or is there more of a strategic decision-making element involved?
So I might touch on, you talked about the flywheel earlier on, and then I'll come into the decision-making. So what we talk about at Vanguard is the flywheel. The more assets we actually bring into Vanguard, the greater the scale benefits, hopefully the better the client experience. That allows us to actually continue moving the flywheel and ultimately leading to us driving scale into the business and therefore being able to actually give these price cuts. In terms of the decisions themselves, it is relatively cut and dried. We actually have prospectus year ends. We have 6 year ends for a range of all of our funds and ETFs. And so when those financial years end for those respective funds and ETFs, we have a decision to make at that period of time. Has that fund or ETF developed enough scale to actually drop the price on that? And in terms of these 21 ETFs you talk about, we actually announced them progressively through the first quarter and second quarter this year so far. And the reason we've been able to actually drop the fees on the ETFs is at Vanguard, we've developed a lot of scale in these ETFs over the last 3 years in particular. And it's actually been the largest category growing at Vanguard. In actual fact, ETFs have actually taken in about 35% of our total cash flow. So the ETFs are driving real scale, so we're able to drop the prices on these ETFs. And yes, you said that our biggest ETFs, like the S&P 500, has dropped from 4 to 3 basis points. But there's been a whole range of ETFs that have dropped.
You mentioned the flows into ETFs and how this has been the fastest growing part of the business. Right now, I believe Vanguard offers 18 ETFs that actually have lower expense ratios than their corresponding Admiral shares, which,
yep,
of course, is a mutual fund share class. Why is there a fee difference here? Is it because of those flows going into ETFs?
That's absolutely the reason. Over the last few years, the ETF category has actually driven more flows. And so as a result of that, we've needed to actually drop the price because we've been able to develop better efficiencies because of the scale in those particular products. So it was purely an economics decision that they've driven the scale there. And we, at some point in the future, we will continue to hopefully drop the Admiral prices as we develop more scale into those products as well.
I saw along with the ETF fee cuts, Vanguard branded a distinct group of ETFs. They're called Vanguard Select ETFs. I believe there are 13 ETFs,
yep,
in all. What was the purpose of doing this?
The purpose is really just to offer a streamlined set of ETF for investors seeking guidance. These 13 ETFs were chosen because they give the investors the building blocks to create a portfolio that meets three important criteria: diversification, low cost, and liquidity. And so we're really just trying to help our investors out. But that said, if you think about our range of ETFs, we tend to offer ones that really meet true investor needs and offer long-term enduring value. So we're not going to just start an ETF because it's a trend in the market. But what we're trying to do in this case is give them a little bit of an easier ability to create a long-term enduring portfolio.
Our guest is Michael Levitt, head of Vanguard's RIA group. Michael, overall, I don't think there's any question Vanguard is synonymous with low-cost investing. So I saw a stat that the average expense ratios for Vanguard's ETFs is 74% less than the industry average. And, of course, there's a term that's been coined, the Vanguard effect, right? This,
yep,
refers to the phenomenon where when Vanguard moves into an investment category or drops fees in a category, everyone else seems to follow suit. It has the effect of bringing costs down across the category. The question I have is, where does this all end with fund fees? I mean, just this year, we've now seen ETFs launch with a zero fee expense ratio after fee waivers. There was a negative fee ETF approved yesterday, again, involving fee waivers. I know there's another U.S. equity ETF that launched with a cost of 2 basis points. What's the end game here?
Well, look, for us, we're quite proud of the fact of the Vanguard effect. We have driven prices down around the globe. So wherever Vanguard is, we've seen prices come down dramatically, and we think that's a great thing for investors. Where it ends, I can't tell you what our competitors are going to do, but we hope from a Vanguard perspective that as we continue to grow, that we will continue to pass on cost savings to our investors. But ultimately, there is actually a cost of running a mutual fund or an ETF. And so there are some products out there that are free or the like. And ultimately, the provider is getting paid somehow. So I'd just say to investors, really be careful about which products you're looking at and what you're actually buying. But we hope as an industry that costs come down, not only in ETF, but mutual funds in passive and active. We think investors are just better off for that fact.
What about commission-free ETF trading? So last week, one of the major brokerages expanded their lineup of commission-free ETFs, I think to around 570 ETFs. Of course, Vanguard already offers nearly every ETF commission-free, excluding some leverage and inverse ETFs. I've said that I think we'll see just about every ETF commission-free nearly everywhere at some point. I guess, again, the Vanguard effect. Do you agree with that?
Look, June last year, we announced that we were making roughly 1,800 ETFs free for trading on our platform out of about an industry number of 2,000. The ones we haven't made free are the inverse equity type ones and things like that, which are quite high risk. But yeah, we think that prices are coming down in terms of trading costs. Whether that ends up at zero, it obviously has on the Vanguard platform. On a number of platforms, already have a number of their ETFs trading free, but not all. We would hope that those costs come down over the next few years.
All right, Michael. So to be fair, we can't talk about fees without talking about financial advisor fees as well. And the spotlight does seem to be shifting here as fund fees approach, zero. Obviously, Vanguard offers a low-cost advisory service. But given your specific role, you're interacting with all sorts of financial advisors on a daily basis, right? So what kind of conversations are you having with advisors around fees?
We're talking to advisors about this all the time. And the first thing I'd say is from an advisor perspective, we haven't actually seen fees come down yet. We suspect that at some point in the future they will come down. There is certainly a lot of talk about it. But what we talk to advisors about is really understand your value proposition. What value are you trying to add to the underlying end investor? If you're just trying to add investment selection and ultimately putting a portfolio together, well, we say to advisors, be really careful because a computer can do that. It can do that at very low cost. It can do that providing market returns using index products. So if that's your value proposition, be really careful because there's going to be a lot of pressure on pricing in that regard with robos or services like Vanguard, which are hybrid, which is a combination of an advisor and a technology solution.
In terms of the range of services, what types of things are we talking about here?
So we would say to advisors, think about if you're a true wealth planner, you're thinking about things like estate planning, tax, insurance. Some are doing some property stuff or accountancy. So it's really extending your range of services. And actually, many RAs already have that and have had it for many, many years. But we would say to those advisors who have been more that investment advisor, not the full wealth planner, think about how you can actually expand the range of services.
I know in addition to providing a range of services and taking a more customized approach, one of the things Vanguard preaches is the importance of behavioral coaching, which is actually where I think advisors can provide perhaps the most value. What does that entail? What do you think is most important here?
So we've come up with this term, advisors alpha, and that's the alpha that an advisor can add to a portfolio above and beyond the investment selection. And we think advisors can add on average about 300 basis points to a client's portfolio. Of that, about half of that is behavioral coaching. And what that really means is is really helping the underlying investor do things that they would normally do. So most of us, common behavioral finance is when markets are down and they're down aggressively, all right, let's get out of the market. Like, we're scared. In actual fact, that's the time you should be buying, or you should be dollar cost averaging back into the market. So behavioral coaching is really about stopping the average person doing what they're thinking is the right thing, but in most cases is not.
Well, Michael, really appreciate your time today. You know, fees are always a hot topic of debate. Thank you for joining us.
No problem at all, Nate. Really enjoyed being here, and I hope you have a great day.
Thank you. That was Michael Lovett, head of Vanguard's RIA Group. Let's take a break, and when we come back, we're going to spotlight a brand new ETF out from Amplify ETFs. This focuses on peer-to-peer lending in the crowdfunding space. We'll be joined by the founder and CEO of Amplify, Christian Magoon. This is ETF Prime. Welcome back to ETF Prime. Let's go right to our ETF Spotlight.
It's time for the ETF Spotlight, where each week we highlight one exchange-traded fund. There are thousands of ETFs available to invest in. ETF Prime has sorted through them all, so you don't have to.
The ETF we're spotlighting this week is the Amplify Crowd Bureau Peer-to-Peer Lending and Crowdfunding ETF. The ticker symbol is LEND, L-E-N-D. This just launched last Thursday, and joining us via phone from Colorado to discuss this ETF is Christian Magoon, founder and CEO of Amplify ETFs. Christian, always a pleasure. Thanks for joining us this week.
Hey, thanks for having me, Nate. Good to hear from you.
So, Christian, let's just dive right in. As I mentioned, this ETF just launched last week. First, explain what this ETF holds and perhaps the basic construction here.
Sure. So there's been a lot of advances in technology and financial regulations that have created this new type of fast-growing category of companies that are trying to disrupt traditional banking around the globe. And these are publicly traded peer-to-peer lending platforms. So in the U.S., an example would be LendingTree or LendingClub. These are, you know, essentially digital lending marketplaces for both consumers and small to medium-sized businesses. And similar to online retail and how it's disrupted traditional brick-and-mortar stores, we're seeing peer-to-peer lenders do the same to traditional banks by offering convenience, selection, and very competitive pricing when it comes to getting a loan. So the ETF, LEND, ticker L-E-N-D, is a basket of global peer-to-peer publicly traded companies located primarily in developed markets in the U.S. as well as in emerging markets in Asia. And the ETF tracks an index, and top 10 holdings are companies that many would be familiar with if you watch some of the advertisements on a weekend, like LendingTree and LendingClub. But many of the names in the top 10, in addition, are some of the top peer-to-peer lenders in Europe and Asia as well. So it brings a lot of diversification to an average investor's portfolio and allows them to invest in something that's disruptive, not in the technology space, but in the financial space.
And how many holdings in total are in the ETF?
There's currently 34 holdings in the ETF.
Okay, and you mentioned peer-to-peer lending. What's the breakdown between companies sort of associated with peer-to-peer lending versus equity crowdfunding?
So currently, there's only one company that qualifies for equity crowdfunding. The index is able to pick up more of those IPOs as they come to market, but currently the vast majority of publicly traded companies that qualify for some of the minimum liquidity and listing standards fit into that peer-to-peer lending space.
And just taking a quick step back, for people who aren't familiar with peer-to-peer lending and equity crowdfunding, can you give us just a high-level explanation, just how these work at a basic level?
Sure. So essentially there are platforms that are created, a platform like a LendingTree or a LendingClub, where consumers have the ability to digitally generally apply for loans. And most of these platforms will have algorithms that sort through risk and other variables to price various loans to consumers. Many times these crowdfunding and peer-to-peer lending platforms have taken in money from a variety of different investors to then redeploy out in the marketplace to consumers or small to medium-sized businesses. In the U.S., we see many of these loans being refinancing of current debt like credit cards or maybe home improvement projects or medical procedures. Outside the U.S., you see many of these loans used to start small businesses or purchase equipment for small to mid-sized businesses. So this is really a kind of a different way than going to a traditional lender, showing up in an office and applying for a loan and getting maybe one offer from a loan officer. Instead, you're doing this potentially from your house on a digital platform and seeing a variety of terms and types of loans being offered to you. And you have the ability to select that as well as generally very competitive pricing because you're in a digital space versus just a traditional brick-and-mortar bank. The pricing of these loans in terms of interest rates tends to be more attractive. It's simply just bringing competition into the space that maybe didn't exist before in the old types of banking models.
Christian, you have a history of launching ETFs and some innovative segments of the market. Why did you see a need for this ETF? Or I guess better put, what's the investment opportunity in this space?
Yeah, so I think the general opportunity in this space is that the financial service area is really ripe for disruption. Many of us don't like going to a bank or even haven't set foot in a bank for a long time. More and more people are moving to digital banking. And for those people, it's much more likely that they are going to use these lending platforms and engage there. So we think there's an opportunity, not unlike some of the other spaces, like, for example, brick and mortar being disrupted by online retail. In addition, there's 1.7 billion people in the world, Nate, that are unbanked. Yet two-thirds of those people, of that 1.7, have smartphones. And we think that their ability to access capital is going to be increased because of these peer-to-peer lending platforms, and we're seeing it in countries outside the U.S. particularly. So we see this as a very interesting growth opportunity. And as you know, a lot of the disruptive growth opportunities tend to be in one sector, which is technology. We think that this is a very unique way to be part of something disruptive, but maybe not own the same technology stocks that you do in many of these other thematics. Instead, you own a very different universe in the financial services area. Indeed, when you look at the top 10 holdings of the Lend ETF, these peer-to-peer lending companies are barely owned by other ETFs. The majority of the top 10 holdings have less than a 1% ownership in the traditional ETF ecosphere. So adds a lot of diversification as well as growth potential, we believe, to an average investor's portfolio.
Christian, that actually brings up something we discussed earlier on the show. We were looking at alternative tech ETFs with ETF.com's Laura Krieger and just talking about how pure play some thematic ETFs are. You know, there aren't always enough good publicly traded investment opportunities available to cover a narrower or more niche segment of the market. Is that a concern here at all?
We don't believe this is a concern. There's enough pure play. Now, keep in mind, we only have 34 holdings currently that qualify, but we think that there are enough companies that fit this play. 80% of the index weight is peer-to-peer lending and crowdfunding platforms. About 14% are public providers of technology and software solutions, so are kind of playing a supportive role. So when you look at it, 94% of the portfolio is either a platform or is supporting a platform from a technology or software perspective. So I think that meets the sniff test, if you will, of trying to be a pure play, peer-to-peer lending ETF.
Christian, you talked about the opportunities in this space. I'm just trying to think through maybe some potential risks. And one that keeps popping up in my mind are maybe scams, right? You have covenant light loans. I'm just thinking about the vetting of deals on equity crowdfunding platforms, you know, somebody raising money and going to Vegas with it. Is fraud an issue here at all or enough to matter?
Well, it's interesting you say that because the peer-to-peer lending space has had a fair amount of issues, even in the last year in China. Most of those peer-to-peer lending platforms, though, have been private and have not been publicly traded. So we definitely think that you need to have invest in publicly traded companies that have a higher level of regulatory scrutiny and produce a higher level of financial filings. Believe it or not, there's about 1,000 peer-to-peer lending platforms that operate in China. Most of those are private, and there's been a pretty good crackdown over the last year, and they're finding that some of these private peer-to-peer lending platforms were actually committing fraud or involved in Ponzi-like schemes. There hasn't been any issues with the publicly traded peer-to-peer lenders, however. So we actually view some of that regulatory crackdown and as very positive for publicly traded companies because they've already had to meet those standards. And, in fact, they were competing against groups that were in the private space that didn't have those issues. You know, I think, certainly some of the risks are the overall consumer and, you know, whether or not the consumer globally is healthy. That could limit some of the lending that happens if we start to see a major slowdown around the world in economies. Also, Lend, because it has about 50% of its portfolio invested in emerging market, publicly traded peer-to-peer platforms, can be a lot more volatile than the traditional financial services ETF. This is something that's growing very quickly. In fact, this year, the index that Lend tracks is up over 40%. So there's quite a bit of volatility here. It's not your grandmother's banking ETF, so to speak.
Our guest is Christian Magoon, founder and CEO of Amplify ETFs. Christian, while we have you on the line and just given what we're seeing in the market recently, look, when we visited back in January, we discussed another ETF you launched. I believe it launched in November, the Amplify Black Swan Growth and Treasury Core ETF, ticker SWAN. Of course, this was during a fairly substantial stock market decline that went into late December. And the idea with this ETF is to provide exposure to the S&P 500, but offer some downside protection as well. I'm just curious, given what we've seen in the market so far in 2019, certainly recently, you know, we had stocks really bounce back. Now we've taken a couple of steps back. How has this ETF responded since inception?
Yeah, we've been really pleased with the Black Swan ETF. So we launched Election Day, and remember, Election Day wasn't a real good day in the market, November 6th. And, you know, from November 6th through December 24th, the S&P was off about 14%. That was kind of in the midst of that very tough decline. While the S&P was off 14% through Christmas Eve, the Black Swan ETF was off only 4%, so held up really well. And then the market had this excellent run to begin the year, and the market was up close to 15%, and the Black Swan ETF kind of returned around 9% during that time frame. But all told right now, as we sit here after this really tough week or so in China, since inception, the Black Swan ETF is now up 5.4%, so November 6th through last night's close. The S&P is up 3.13%. So we've seen over 230 basis points of outperformance from the Black Swan ETF. But maybe more importantly, Nate, it's provided a much smoother ride. So when the S&P at its lows was down, you know, close to 14%, the Swan was nowhere near that. And, you know, that's what we tried to do with this ETF is offer a product that had S&P-like upside, but also had the safety of having U.S. Treasuries. So even in the last 2 or 3 days when we've seen the S&P off 4 to 5%, we've seen the Black Swan off only about half that amount. So this is a kind of an interesting product for those who are maybe nearing retirement or who are in retirement, who can't afford to take maybe a 20 or 25%, 30% loss of principal, even though that may be short-term on the S&P 500. But at the same time, they need some S&P 500-like growth. And the Black Swan ETF really kind of allows you to have kind of both sides of the fence, participate in the S&P 500, but have some significant protection against a major decline in the S&P 500. So we're really pleased with the Swan ETF, you know, trades on the NYSE and currently has about $75 billion in assets in it.
Christian, it's Connor Kelly. Switching gears here just for a second, I wanted to bring up iBuy, your online retail ETF, which is, you know, by all, you know, ratings of in terms of performance and gathered a huge amount of assets. You guys are at over $250 million, I believe. But it seems like a broad theme is the fact that so many people have cell phones and this revolution of where, especially overseas, like you mentioned, it 1.7 people are unbanked but have a mobile phone. And it almost seems like globally, you guys, that's a broader theme when you look at both Lend plus iBuy, that the fact that the rest of the world's kind of skipping a few steps, so to speak, and just jumping right into online and mobile everything. Is that kind of an underlying theme in what you guys see, broadly speaking, for your ETF launches?
Yeah, it's a good point, Connor. We definitely see the smartphone and really this kind of increased internet penetration along with a mobile device that's highly functional as something that, you know, is really moving certain industries. And you're exactly right. I mean, if you look at online retail, smartphone usage is really the fastest growing area of e-commerce. It's growing, you know, close to six times that of e-commerce that's done on laptop computers, for example. And that is fueling online retail. iBuy, which we launched a little over 3 years ago, just became a five-star rated fund, the number one consumer cyclical ETF over the last 3 years, according to Morningstar. So we're excited to have that five-star rating. We recently launched XBuy that invests in all the online retailers outside the U.S., and that has actually outperformed iBuy since its inception. And then, you know, to your point on Lend, we see increased internet access and smartphone usage being highly predictive of people around the world doing more and more of their banking and their loan business online. So, yeah, we think that is a great catalyst, and we're trying to kind of understand and provide access within Amplify's product line to these unique areas of the market that stand to benefit the most, at least we believe, over the next, you know, 3 to 10 years.
Well, Christian, we're out of time, so we'll have to leave it there. Always enjoy chatting. Best of luck on the new ETF. Certainly look forward to visiting again soon. Thank you.
Thanks, Connor. Take care.
That was Christian Magoon, founder and CEO of Amplify ETFs. And you can learn more about Len, Swan, iBuy, and their other ETFs by visiting amplifyetfs.com. That'll do it for this week's show. I want to thank our exclusive sponsor, Legg Mason. You can visit leggmason.com to learn more about their broad range of investment strategies. Podcasts of ETF Prime are available at etfprime.com, etf.com, iTunes, and Spotify. You can follow me on Twitter, at Nate Geraci. Next week, Phil Bock, CEO of Exponential ETFs, will discuss their reverse cap-weighted ETF and also field our rapid-fire ETF questions. And then Todd Sunderland, partner and head of quant strategies at Cushing, will spotlight their Sector Plus ETFs, which focus on the energy space. Until then, have a great week, everyone.